you all now to stand for our Gaboury song, "As You're Able." Christ is risen, shout Hosanna.
Every single person that lives in a different place has a so many different
ones. Yeah, with different writings of it, and different letters.
Very good.
Yeah.
And numbers too, right, exactly. So I'm going to show you this. This is a different kind of alphabet, right? This is the Greek alphabet. And you know what was written in the Greek language, this Greek alphabet? The Bible, a lot of it was. So in the Greek alphabet, the first letter, it looks like an A, doesn't it? But it's called alpha. And that's the last letter. Looks like, what does it look like?
A horseshoe.
A horseshoe. It does, doesn't it?
Horseshoe.
And the name of that last letter is omega. So in the English alphabet, we have A to Z, and in the Greek alphabet, we have alpha to omega. We're going to talk about that a little bit in the scriptures when we read it today. And what that says is God is with us from A to Z, from alpha to omega, from the beginning to end. And God is also with us all through the rest of, in the middle too, all through everything. God is with us all day, every day, from the day we were born to the day we go to be with Jesus at the end of our life. So, let's say a little prayer, okay? Dear Lord, you are our Alpha and Omega. Please help us each day to follow you and to feel safe and happy, knowing that you are the first and the last thing in my life every single day. Amen. I want you guys to listen for the Alpha and Omega in the Bible reads, okay? And you're done.
Thank you.
peace. Be still. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Jesus has come to bring you new life. Believe in him. Receive the blessing of hope and peace. Amen.
The Hebrew reading for today is Psalm 150, and we'll read responsibly if you would join me to read the dark print. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary.
Praise God in his mighty firmament.
Praise God for his mighty deeds.
Praise God for his exceeding greatness.
Praise God with trumpet sound.
Praise God with lute and harp.
Praise God with tambourine and dance.
Praise God with strings and pipes.
Praise God with sounding cymbals.
Praise God with loud clashing cymbals.
Let everything that breathes praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So, how do we celebrate Easter on the second Sunday of Easter? The Easter eggs have all been eaten. The crowds of worshipers are gone. The alleluias have faded, and unfortunately, most of us return from our glorious Easter service to the same old life, with all its difficulties that we knew before Easter. So what's changed? The question becomes, in the difficulties we face, how do we affirm the reality of the risen Christ? So how about this? How about we jump into our Wayback Machine, and we travel back in time, say, about 1,918 years, to the end of the first Christian century, around the year 100 AD, give or take a few years. As Christians, we would have gathered to worship in a comfortable and elaborately decorated, sanctuary, but in a house church, somewhere probably in Asia Minor, roughly where Turkey is today. It's been some 66 years or so since the life and death and resurrection of Jesus. Most who are alive at that time that Jesus had been resurrected are gone. Most have died. Some were even killed for being a Christian. So as we meet to worship, we are confused and a little frightened. We're confused because it's hard to know who Christians are anymore. Yes, the worshipers of Jesus, the crucified and risen one, initially were mostly Jewish. Now, thanks to the efforts of the Apostle Paul and others, Christians also included those who were never Jewish, but formerly pagans. Of those, few were well-to-do, because Christianity has spread primarily among the lower classes. There are probably even a few former slaves present. Nobody has much prestige or money. Plus, over the last 25 years, life had gotten really complicated due to the destruction of Jerusalem and the Jewish homeland during the Roman War. So many Jews and Jewish Christians have migrated, and some even to Asia Minor. And there is tension between the Jews and the Christians, and even between Christians and Christians. Previously, the association with Judaism provided a bit of cover with the Roman Empire. But that's changed. And now Christians have become a misunderstood and persecuted minority. Not by the Roman Empire, but by some narrow-minded officials and locals who don't understand Christianity. Jesus, after all, had been crucified as a rebel and enemy of the public welfare. As a Christian, as long as you're under the radar, you're okay. But should you get questioned for engaging in illegal cultic practices, well, that could prove tricky and even deadly. You see, it's like this. If questioned, you might be told that you must prove your loyalty to Rome by offering wine and incense before images of the Roman gods, including Caesar, who fancied himself as a god. All you have to say are two words, Kyrios Kasaros, meaning Caesar is Lord. The problem is, though, that's exactly the opposite of the Christian confession, which is Jesus is Lord. So what do you do? Do you renounce your faith in Jesus in order to save your life and the lives of your family? Well, understandably, some do that. In this first century congregation, there may be such people that are sitting right next to you today. Do you close your eyes and cross your fingers and say it under duress, hoping that Jesus and the others will forgive you? Again, some, including perhaps some sitting next to you, have done so. Or do you stick by your faith, refusing to bow to Caesar, acknowledging only Jesus? At the very least, as a Christian in a pagan society, you're likely to face social and economic discrimination, tension and harassment, perhaps even mob violence and the plundering of property. At worst, you will be sentenced to death, to die as a martyr. That word in Greek, martyr, literally means witness, which tells you that at that time and place, to witness to your faith often meant to die for it. So as you sit there on that Sunday morning, given such circumstances, exactly what does it mean to call Jesus the Christ Lord, the one who reigns? Interestingly, on that day in this congregation, there's a new text to be read in worship. It's a letter written by a banished Jewish Christian prophet named John. He himself is in prison for his faith. He's in exile on the island of Patmos. The letter is not intended to be read privately, and really many cannot read anyway, but it's meant to be read aloud during worship. Hear the first 8 verses of chapter 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testified to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the word of the prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it, for the time is near. John, to the 7 churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the 7 spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priests, serving his God and Father, to him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming in the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and on his account all the tribes of all the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Okay, wow. And that's only the salutation. Welcome to the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is both comforted and has confounded Christians for 19 centuries, raising questions in all who read it. For sure, the book of Revelation is not the place to begin your study of the Bible, although out of curiosity, that's what many people actually do. After all, Revelation was written to people who felt like their world was falling apart. So throughout the centuries, whenever people have found themselves living in unsettled times, they have found themselves understood by John the Revelator, who calls for faith and faithfulness. It strikes a responsive chord in the distressed saints. While much remains unclear, the purpose of the book is very clear. It was written primarily to encourage and inspire particular Christians who were under Roman persecution. It was to inspire them to stay strong and to remain faithful through those troubling times. It addressed both the internal battles waged within Christian believers between personal faithfulness and the abandonment of faith, and the external battles posed by living as a Christian in a culture that was out of control, threatened by unenlightened leaders and pagan values. Although in many ways the times of the book of Revelation are unlike our own, there are other ways in which that time is very much like our own. John lived in a pre-Christian society before there were a common Christian culture and values. The Christians to whom he wrote were minorities in a diverse world. To live as a Christian in such a society often meant being a lonely witness to the way of Jesus, living in a culture way. Now we live in a post-Christian world, in the residue of Christendom, in which the church is again a minority in a diverse world. Once again, to live as a Christian means to live as a witness in the way of Jesus and living in a counter-cultural way. No wonder John calls to faithfulness resounds powerfully to contemporary generations. Nowhere in the book of Revelation does it say that it will be easy, despite the escapist theology many claim to find there. At the risk of oversimplifying a complex book, let me share a real-life example. A couple, they were driving the treacherous mountain roads in Colorado. As they rounded a curve, they came upon a serious motorcycle accident. The driver was without a helmet, and he was thrown quite a distance, and the bike had landed not far away from him. The man who was driving pulled off the road, and before he could shut off the engine, the woman had jumped out of the car and was at the side of the accident victim. She crouched next to him. He was unconscious, She was stroking his hair and talking to him. When the ambulance arrived, the young man was whisked away. The man and the woman got back in their car in silence. After a short amount of time, the man said, "I saw you talking to that young man. He was obviously unconscious, and he may have even been dead. What could you possibly have been saying to him?" She replied, "I kept telling him that the worst is over and the healing has begun." For those to whom John wrote, whose lives were marked by weakness and denial, terror and fear, who were haunted by the past, anxious over the present and fearful of the future, to them, or to us, God, through the words of John the Revelator, offers a vision of hope. The worst is over. The healing has begun. And that's how, on this second Sunday of Easter, even in the midst of the difficulties we face, we affirm the reality of the risen Christ. Let's continue to make that so. Amen. Please stand as you are able for our song of response, "Love Divine, All Love Excelling."
Thank you.
receivers of grace, receivers of Jesus, we are givers, following God's call, following Jesus, following our hearts. Lord, we give these offerings for the work of your kingdom, with humble thanks for mercy received. Amen.
Please be seated. Let us bow our heads and open our hearts. God of mystery and love, like Jesus' first followers, just 2 weeks out from the startling events of Holy Week, we struggle to make sense of all that has happened. The death of Jesus on the cross shatters not only our preconceptions of what it means to proclaim that Jesus is the Anointed One, but also our foundational beliefs about you. How could a God of love let this happen? Was this part of your plan? Even more perplexing, what does it mean that you yourself died upon that cross? Reflecting on the miracle of Easter, the stories we have heard of an empty tomb, and the reports that some have seen the risen Christ challenge our fundamental notions of how the world works. We long to believe that it is true, but some of us are haunted with doubts. We believe, Lord, help our unbelief. Looking back on these events that changed the world, help us to see your love revealed in surprising ways. Help us to recognize your love in your children. Help us to recognize your love in the humility of Jesus. Help us to recognize your love in the trauma of the cross, the suffering you share with all who suffer. Help us to recognize your love in the risen Christ. Help us to recognize your love in faith that goes beyond belief. Even more, gracious God, help us to express your love. Make it a part of who we are and how we live. Help us to love you with our entire beings and to love each other as ourselves. Where there is pain and suffering, may we respond in love. Where there is loneliness and grief, may we respond in love. Where there is sickness and death, may we respond in love. Where there is hunger and homelessness, may we respond in love. Where there is iniquity and oppression, may we respond in love. Not only this, O Lord, but give us also courage to speak your love, to articulate what we believe even as we speak our doubts so loud, to confess our failures and share our fears, to proclaim the good news of your love in Christ, to testify and bear witness to the ways you have changed us, and to the ways you continue to change us. Let us be bold in using the words Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now, peace to you from the one who is, and was, and is to come. Grace and peace to you from the one who loves us and frees us, the one who gives us repentance and forgiveness. As God sent Jesus into the world, so the Spirit now sends us to continue God's holy work. To God be the glory and the authority forever and ever. Amen. I would just like to now lift up a few announcements just to take with you on your journey out of here. First of all, I don't know about you, but I'm so over winter. And so what we're going to be doing next week, and here's your visual, everyone will get one of these. So tell your neighbors, your friends, come. We will be having a Hawaiian-themed service next week with Hawaiian music, and it's going to be an extravaganza. I'm just going to say that. So please come for this Aloha Spirit service. Wear your Hawaiian shirts. I am actually going to wear a mumu. I don't stand out. So come in your garb and be filled with the Aloha Spirit. Mike, do you want to say a word or two about Dorothy coming for mission?
We have the person who planned the mission trip that I was just on this past winter and who has done several, probably more than I can count, mission trip planning, is going to be here tomorrow night. She's going to be speaking at 7 o'clock. We're having a meeting here at church. Anyone who wants to come and hear about planning a mission trip, being in mission, she's a great speaker. She's got a lot of enthusiasm, so everyone's invited. I'm going to try to gather a few pizzas for us and maybe a few other snacks. So it'll be a good time. Anyone who wants to show up, it'll be great.
Dorothy is a retired gym teacher from the cities, and so she knows how to deliver. So she's going to be great. I love Dorothy Moran. So 7 o'clock here tomorrow, having some dinner and listening and having a conversation with Dorothy about missions. All right. Okay, this is Al Anderson's request. He is trying desperately to get our database up and going, especially around email and that sort of thing, and how to communicate best with everybody. So he would love it if you sent him an email just saying, "Hi Al, how are you?" That way he could have your email addresses and he could get it into his system. So just send an email to UCTH@UCTH.org. It's in your bulletin. So just, if you wouldn't mind doing that sometime this week, he would be forever grateful. And then, yes.
Can I just add to that one little thing?
Yes, please.
People might not be aware, but he's doing a little blog on our church page, and it's very fun and entertaining and cute. And if you haven't gotten to it, he's good at it.
He's good at a lot of things, actually. Anyway, I could go on and on. And so speaking of Al, on May 6th, another must come to service. It's going to be a music-filled service with multiple different groups singing, solos. He's gathering all that together. And so if you have ever had an urge to provide some sort of music, whether it's instrument or singing or whatever it is, please talk to Al, and he will fit you into this service. It's going to be May 6th. It's going to be amazing, so please, everybody, come to that. Are there any other announcements you would like to lift up? Mike and I are going to go to fences this afternoon, so if anybody wants to come sit with us, that'd be great. All right. If there are not, let us stand as you are able for our singing song, "You Servants of God."